vorstellen?
And today I want to present a framework that we are working on. It's called Gradoop and it's about scalable graph analytics and it's based on Apache Flink. So let me introduce myself and my team. So I'm working with graphs for quite a while. I wrote my bachelor thesis on partitioning of graphs and my master thesis on graphs in business intelligence. This is my colleague Andre. He has a strong background in business intelligence, and so we work together on that project. And those are our two students that also are involved in our project. So let's start with some motivation. I guess all of you know what a graph is, but let me give you a short reminder. So in its basic structure, it's a set of vertices, the blue circles that are connected by edges. So this is a really interesting data structure, and there's this quote from the Neo4j guys, a graph database vendor, that tells us that graphs are everywhere, which means this data model can be applied in a lot of applications. So one application, if you add some information to your vertices and your edges, as for example a social network, so where the vertices are users that are connected by friendship relations. So, and what you can do in such a network using that data model, you can ask questions like recommender questions. So things like, what are possible friends for Alice? So people that are not directly connected to Alice, but to the friends of the friends of Alice. And so this is typically used in the recommender engines. A bit more global question is, so for example, what's the shortest path between Alice and Mallory in that case? So if you think about LinkedIn and you look at another person's profile, you see how you are connected to that person. This is essentially a shortest path between the two users. And even a bit more global, you can ask questions like, what are components or what are clicks in my social network, which is quite interesting. So, and if you look at the data structure and you add a bit more detail to it, so like directions on edges, you can essentially model something like Twitter, so where you have where you place the friendship relation by a follower relationship. And an analyst could be interested in finding influential people, so people that have a high incoming degree, so a lot of follower relationships, so for example for advertisement placement, something like that. So, and if you add even more information, so like attributes on edges and vertices, you can also take this into account when you compute something. So, for example, short trip through Germany by train, you want to visit every city and you want to take the shortest path, the shortest tour, and things like that. So as many of you know, graph algorithms can be very expensive in computational and also in time complexity. And this gets even worse when you think about very large networks like social networks, Facebook with a lot of users, or the thing at the bottom, the World Wide Web, where we compute the page rank, so the influence of a website or the importance of a website, which is also a global graph algorithm. So, but it's not only about the analytical part, it's also about the thing that we call end-to-end graph analytics. So, and this is mainly, this consists of three steps, which I will explain shortly. So, when you think about graph analytics, at first what you have to do, you have to transform your data that you want to compute on, you have to transform it into a graph. This may sound easily, but mostly your data isn't stored as a graph. You have to transform it in some way from a relational database or from some NoSQL store or from files. So you have to say, what is a vertex, what is an edge? So is every foreign key in a relational database, is this an edge, or what do you do with that? So other problems that occur here are object matching. Yeah, you have to say entity in multiple source systems, you want to map it to one vertex in your graph, for example. So what we do in the first step is we transform those sources into a common graph data model, and we store this integrated graph in a dedicated graph store. So the next step, this is the important step on graph analytics. So what we think is necessary here is that you give an analyst, or so a data scientist or a big data analyst, operators which he can use to form analytical workflows based on the integrated graph. So things like detect communities in the first step, then he's only interested in communities that have more than, let's say, 100 users, and then he takes those communities and extracts pattern from the communities to see how they are structured. And the third, and it's a very important step, is the representation of graphs. So we saw, if you saw the talk from Vasya yesterday, she had a nice representation in Gephi, for example. So this is something an analyst can work with. So you can see the picture and then you can make assumptions of what's happening here. And this is a very important step in end-to-end graph analytics. And even if you want to combine it with regular or with traditional approaches like bar charts and stuff like that. So, and when you look at existing graph data management systems, you can essentially see three different categories. You have graph database systems like Neo4j, OrientDB, graph processing systems like Giraffe, for example, and distributed workflow systems, so things like Flink with Jelly or Spark with GraphX. And if you compare those systems in terms of end-to-end graph graph analytics, you can see that none of these systems is a perfect match for the use case. So for example, Neo4j as a graph database offers a very rich graph data model. You can do a lot of data modeling in using their property graph model, but they are tailored to local asset operations, so it's essentially a database, so you want to have transactions and stuff like that. And they have a query language, which is very nice, and they are very good at scaling vertically, so you can get a lot of performance out of it if you have a very big machine. But they don't have any tools for data integration, like I described it before. They don't do graph analytics in the sense of global graph queries, so things where you need to compute the whole graph. And they have some support for representation, so nice JavaScript UIs and stuff like that. So the second category, Giraffe, for example, these are frameworks which are tailored to graph analytics in the terms of you want to compute the whole graph in your computation, like PageRank, for example, connected components. They have a very generic graph model, so if you want to add some semantics to your data model, you have to add it in your application, so it doesn't come out of the box. And nice thing is that they scale in a horizontal way, so the graph is partitioned. This is a really hard problem, but they do it just by hash partitioning, so there's a lot of work to do in that case. And the third category are distributed workflow systems, which also have a generic data model. If you want to extend it, you have to do it in your application. It's not out of the box. But an interesting point is the second, the combination of global data and graph operations. So you can do things like MapReduce, join cogroup, and so on, and combine it with graph operators, which is very nice. And it also scales horizontal. But there's also missing support for data integration, like I described it before, and also for representation. So we thought about it, and we thought, yeah, what's missing? And we said, OK, what's missing is an end-to-end framework, and for us, a research platform for the efficient, distributed, and domain-independent graph data management and analytics. And this is essentially a Gradoop. So I will start with the architecture and our data model. So this is a high-level view of our current architecture. So we built on HDFS and Yarn. HBase is currently our distributed graph store. So this is where the graph is stored, and we load it and write it from there. On top of that, there's the extended property graph model, which I will explain in detail on the later slides. And our main component is in the middle, where the squirrel sits. So we use Flink for our operator implementation. So we have operators tailored to each of those steps of end-to-end analytics. So for data integration, graph analytics, and representation. And those operators are meant to be implemented in Flink. And on top of that, it's all about workflow declaration. And at the moment, we are building a draft for a domain-specific language called Grala. It's a graph analytical language. And there's also the representation layer, so things like web UIs and stuff like that. So in the talk, I will focus on their model, the operators for analytics, graph analytics, and I will give some introductional things about the domain-specific language. So let's talk about the data model. I will use an example to explain it. It makes things very easy. So, of course, our graph contains vertices. You can see them here. They are all red. Their properties are they have a unique identifier. It's just an ID. Each vertex has a unique label. So it has a label. And it can have a set of properties. So, for example, let's look at the labels. We have tags and forums and persons inside this example. And they have properties like in the form of key-value pairs, like, for example, name Eve or title graph processing. So it's key-value. And there's no schema involved. So if a vertex has a label person, it doesn't mean that it has to have this set of properties, name, gender, whatever. For example, this person in the bottom, Frank, he has additional properties in comparison to the other persons. So this is the first class citizen in our data model. The second one are edges. And edges are binary and they are directed, which means they connect at most two vertices. Each edge has also a unique identifier, has a label. So for example, a person is interested in a tag, or a forum has a tag, or a forum has moderators and members. And also edges can have properties, like the since property, which you see here. So this is essentially the so-called property graph model. It's nothing new. It exists for a while now. It's integrated in, for example, Neo4j or OrientDB. And we added a little extension, which we think is useful for a lot of use cases. And this is a concept called logical graphs, which are essential subgraphs in your graph database. So those logical graphs can be used to model a semantic or technical subgraphs. So things like in this example, we have a three logical graphs, 0, 1, and 2. And each of this logical graph describes a community. So for example, the graph 0 here on the bottom left contains users that are either interested directly in the tag databases or are part of a member of a forum that has the tag databases. So this is the database community, this is the Hadoop community, and this is the graphs community. And what you see here is that those communities can, of course, overlap. So vertices and edges can be in more than one logical graph. And the interesting thing is that that these graphs are first-class citizens of the data model, and so you can apply operators on logical graphs and on collections of logical graphs. So, and this is what I will introduce next, the operators. So we have four categories of operators. The first one are binary operators. Like the name says, they take two logical graphs as input and combine either a logical graph or some value. So simple operations like, for example, the combination where you have an output graph that contains all vertices and edges from the input graph. This can be easily mapped, for example, to the union operator in Jelly. Same applies for overlap. Overlap is not offered by Jelly, but we can implement it easily and exclude, for example. So let me give you an example. Makes things easy. So let's start with combination, for example. So we have this line here is Krala, so the graph analytical language. What it does is essentially very easy. You assign a variable person graph and the result, it's getting assigned to the result of that short workflow where we combine our three logical graphs. So we access the first logical graph using our graph database and the index of the logical graph, combine it with ID 1 and combine that result with 2. And yeah, as you might think, the result is, of course, the combination of all our logical graphs, which contains, in that case, all persons and their nose relationships. So the second category of operators are unary operators. Unary operators are very interesting. They take a single logical graph as input and return in a graph collection or in a single logical graph. So a very important operator in graph-based systems is pattern matching. What you want to do here, you have a pattern graph, so something like give me all users that are a moderator of a forum which has a tag database, for example. And the result would be a collection of logical graphs because the result would be all instances of this graph pattern. A more simple operator is aggregation. Aggregation takes a logical graph as input and an aggregate function. And you can compute the aggregate function on your input graph. So for example, the number of vertices inside your logical graph is a very easy aggregate function, or the average degree in your logical graph. Or you can also apply an aggregate function on the properties of your vertices and edges inside the logical graph. Projection, in our case, is a structure-preserving operator, which means it takes a logical graph as input and applies a projection function on vertices and on edges, which is sometimes useful if you want to, for example, normalize properties at vertices and edges, or if you want to just delete the properties and just keep the label because it makes your computation in the next step easier. And also a very interesting operator is summarization, which is kind of a structural aggregation. I will show it to you using an example. It makes this operator easy. So let's say we have again our person graph, which is a combination of our existing logical graphs, and we want to summarize this graph by the cities the users live in. So for example, what we do here is we define in line 2 a vertex grouping keys. So this is something we want to group the vertices on. For example, on the type, which is the label, it's a symbol, and on the city, so the property key city. And we also want to group the edges based on their type, so on their label. It doesn't matter here because all edges have a nose label, but it would matter if it if there were heterogeneous edges in our logical graph. So what we can also do is we can apply aggregate functions on those summaries of vertices and summaries of edges. In our example, we want to compute just the number of vertices that are represented by a summarized vertex, and the same for the edges. So we want to know essentially how many users live in a specific city, and how many connections are between cities, and how many connections are internal. So in line 6, we apply this using the summarize operator. And the result would be that graph, also a logical graph, which contains exactly that information that we wanted. We have three nodes. Each node represents a city. And we aggregate the users that live inside the city. And we aggregate the edges between users in the same city. And so, for example, the edges between the users in Dresden, there are three edges from Dresden users to Leipzig users. So this is essentially the result of that operator. This may sound really simple, but you can use it for a lot of cases. So for example, in data integration, when you don't know anything about your data, the first thing you do, you summarize your graph based on vertex and edge labels. And what is coming out essentially is the schema of your graph. And you know how the graph looks like, or what is contained in the graph. It also can be used for other operators, like pattern matching as an index, for example. So the next category are collection operators. Like I said, you can apply operators on logical graphs and also on collections of logical graphs. So those operators are rather simple. Things like a selection, you want to filter a set of logical graphs out of a collection of logical graphs using a predicate function. Things like distinct are clear, sort by, top. And here we have union, intersection, difference. Now you may recognize why we had to use combine and overlap and exclude in the binary operators. So yeah, this is essentially set operators on graphs of collections, collections of graphs, sorry. Select is an easy example. What we do here is we define a collection using that syntax. So our collection contains the three logical graphs. We define a predicate function that tells us, give me just those graphs that have more than three vertices. And then we say, apply this predicate using the select operator, and the result would of course be the single graph, one collection with a single graph, two, that has four vertices. So the last category, it's more auxiliary operators. They can be used to apply, for example, a unary graph operator on a graph collection. So if you want to, for example, apply an aggregate function on each logical graph in your input collection, you can use the apply operator. If you want to reduce a collection to a single graph, maybe using the combine operator, you can use the reduce operator. And call is a more generic operator. It's more like the run operator in Jelly, so you can apply any algorithm that returns or that takes a graph or a graph collection as input and returns a graph or a graph collection. So how do we represent this in Flink? Our first approach, it's quite simple. I think everyone would do it this way. So this was our first approach. We have three different data objects that describe our first class citizens in a data model. So we have an object for vertices, edges, and graphs, so logical graphs. So each of them has the special fields, so like the ID, the label, and the properties. And so the vertices and the edges are a bit special. They know in which logical graphs they are in, which makes implementing the operators a bit easier. And we model them as POJOs and use the data set, the data sets to actually represent them inside Flink. And we wrap our vertex and edge data set in a Jelly graph and add an additional data set, including subgraphs, which is also a tuple 2 type, storing an ID and POJO which we defined here. So this is our first simple approach. It's also currently in our master branch, but we also have a second approach where we model the same data object as tuples and store them directly in the data sets. And I was listening to the talks before, which were a bit more technical, and I think this should be a bit more faster than the upper approach. So yeah, let's see how this performs. So as you can see, we really use Flink operators. So please don't be afraid of all the little numbers. I don't go into detail here, but it's just that you can see how we, for example, implement summarization in Flink. It's quite simple, actually. You have a set of vertices, and you have a set of edges, and we use a bit of grouping. So it's a simplified version here. So the operator is more generic than here shown here, but it just gives you an idea. So we have the three cities, Leipzig, Dresden, Berlin, with our users. We group them by city and select a representative in each group, which is then replaced in the edge data set. The source and target vertex are replaced by the group representative. And so on, using that way, we can construct a summarized representation of vertices and a correct edge representation that also only connects vertices that are contained in our summarized vertex set. So it just gives you an idea how we use this. And yeah. So, but let's get a bit more into what we want to eventually build on that system. So we have a use case from business intelligence. And if you think about business intelligence, you mostly think about companies that want to make money or want to get knowledge about their operational data. And what they typically do is they build things like data warehouses. Yes, many firms do this. And typically, in these data warehouses, they use things like so-called star schemas or snowflake schemas, where you have facts about your operational data in the middle, and you have dimensions that describe this fact. So the problem with this approach is that those dimensions, so the relationships between dimensions and facts, are kind of assumptions. So an analyst says, okay, dimension 1, 2, 3 leads to the fact. But what's happening here is he throws away a lot of information he doesn't assume has something to do with that the fact is actually the fact as it is. So what we want to do here is to not throw away the information and preserve all the original data, integrate it as a graph, and do some data mining on that graph. So we do this by extracting subgraphs, so-called business transaction graphs. I will show you an example of that. And then we use those subgraphs using aggregation operators and frequent pattern mining operators to analyze them. So I have to give you some prerequisites. So actually, what's happening left of the yellow oval here is all related to data integration. So what happens before is we have multiple data sources where we extract a schema from the sources in a so-called unified metadata graph, which is enriched with domain knowledge. And based on that unified metadata graph, we can automatically extract graph data from various data sources into a so-called integrated instance graph. So, and this is where our use case starts now. So this is where the analytics starts. What we want to do first is to extract those business transaction graphs. So here's a very, very simple example of how a business transaction graph, which I from now on will call BTG, looks like. So in a BTG, you have two kinds of vertices, which is, if you are from business intelligence domain, then you this may be familiar. You have so-called master data objects, so things like employees or customers or products, though those master data objects can occur in multiple BTGs. And you have, and another thing about master data is that it can be present in multiple data sources. So for example, you have a customer issue tracking system and you have an ERP system, and your employee Alice is an entity in both of those systems, so in both data sources. And so this all was already merged during data integration. But the second, so we have those master data objects, and the second kind of vertices we have here are transactional objects, which means those are vertices that are generated during a business process. So I mean, let me give you a short example what those little labels mean. So let's assume that you have a company that is building Death Stars. So everyone knows what Death Stars are. So, and you have a customer who wants to have a Death Star, and so you write a quotation. That's the first thing you do, and say, here's my fancy Death Star. You want to buy it. And then the customer comes and says, okay, it's approved. So he buys your Death Star, and so you have your sales order. To actually build a Death Star, you need a lot of material, so things like steel and a powerful laser to destroy planets, of course. And so you have to do some purchase orders which are related to your sales order, which lead eventually to expenses. So you have to pay money to build your Death Star, and you, of course, you want that your expenses are less than your revenue. Your revenue is the thing that you get out of your business process, so yeah, what you earn with it. But as it usually happens with big building projects, they take some time and it's delayed and the customer gets angry and he writes a ticket or he has a complaint. You have to write a ticket, which leads to expenses. So this is a very simple example of a business transaction graph. So and what we want to do first is we want to extract those from our integrated instance graph. So this is a set, and each of those BTGs represents an instance of a business process. So it's very easy to extract it. We just use the call for collection operator on our integrated instance graph. And we use a specific algorithm, which is called business transaction graph. It is actually implemented using the BSP API from Jelly. And the result of that operator would be a collection. So the collection is stored at the variable BTGs. So now you want to analyze those BTGs and you have to give them a measure. So a very simple measure for company data is profit. So the profit is hidden in vertices that create expenses and revenue. And essentially, it's just the sum of all revenue minus the sum of all expenses. So it's very easy. You can just define an aggregate function which essentially computes what I just said. And then you want to apply this on your collection and you want to store the profit on each of your logical graphs. You can do this by applying the just defined aggregate function on your set of collection of BTGs, and you store the result at a new property key which is called profit. So after that call, each of those BTGs has a new property, profit, which has the value, which is the result of the aggregate function. So now we want to cluster those BTGs. Let's also take a very simple approach here. Let's just say, okay, if the profit is greater than zero, then it's a positive a profit BTG, and if it's less than zero, it's a loss BTG. So easy clustering method. You can just do it by defining a predicate, which just says that, yeah, if the input graph on the property profit is the value is greater than zero, then it's true, else it's false. And then you just apply this using the select operator. So you have a resulting collection which just contains those BTGs that fulfill the predicate. And if you want to have the lost BTGs, it's just a difference of your initial collection minus the profit BTGs. So now begins the very interesting part and the more graph-related part. What we want to do now is we want to search for patterns that are characteristic for both of those clusters. So there are very easy patterns, like a sales revenue was created by an employee. This is also something you can easily do in a data warehouse, for example. But there can also be very complex patterns where multiple transactional objects are involved and, for example, a single employee is involved. So what we want to do is we want to find patterns that occur only in profit BTGs, so in BTGs that lead to profit. So like, for example, when Alice processed a ticket, then this BTG is positive, which doesn't mean that this is the reason, but this is an interesting pattern because it occurred only in this cluster. Or things like if a purchase order was created by Bob, it's the opposite. So this pattern only occurs in BTGs that are in the other cluster. And the computational interesting thing is how to find those patterns. So what we did here is, at first, we have our two clusters, and what we do here is we also apply an algorithm with the call for collection operator, which is called frequent subgraphs. Frequent subgraphs, given an input collection, it gives you a set of patterns that it occurs in at least, in that case, 70% of your input graphs. So this is a very interesting algorithm. We used the delta iteration to implement it. It's running. It's not tuned at the moment, but it's running. And we are really excited about it. And when you apply this algorithm on your input graphs, you get, of course, the patterns for the profit BTGs and the patterns for the loss BTGs. And let's say you want to get rid of the patterns that occur in both collections. So you just use the intersect operator to extract the trivial patterns that occur in both clusters, and then you can just use the different operator to subtract the trivial patterns from your profit patterns, and the same for the loss patterns. So this would essentially be the result of our analytical question. So it's as you see, well, not many lines to define that. Of course, the algorithms behind it are very interesting and very expensive. But our focus is that the data analyst or big data scientist has to use it, and so this is what we would offer, or what we offer to a data scientist. So let's look at the current state of our implementation and future work. And it's a very young project. We started at the beginning of 2015. So what we first did is we implemented our operators using MapReduce, and for the more iterative operators, we used Giraffe. And we got a lot of experience there, and it was very interesting. But the problem began when we combined those operators, because you have to move the data from one framework to another framework. So we used HDFS at first, later HBase, which increased the performance, but it was not really what we expected. And of course, also in the first talk from ResearchGate, he mentioned, or he showed you the code complexity from a MapReduce program compared to a Flink program. And this is also something I can sign this quote, because this also applies here. So for example, if you ever wrote a Giraffe program, which is more than connected components, then you may know that it can be very complex. So we said, okay, maybe we should look for other frameworks that we could build on top. And we looked at Flink, and this was in June. And we said, okay, let's try it out. So we implemented our very first simple abstraction on it, and we started building operators. And it went really quick, and we had good results in really a short time. And currently, we are building our CC003 snapshot with some performance improvements and more operator implementations, which you can see in that table here. So what you have here, the green operators, they're all already working. You can use them if you want. And the orange operators are either work in progress or have not started yet. So for example, pattern matching is something I will work on next. And my colleague, for example, he's working on FSM. So like I said, it's working already, but it's not tuned. I wouldn't recommend to use it. I don't know how it behaves on the cluster. So let's wait for this. What we also want to do is we want to integrate some of those operators into Flink and Jelly. So there's also an issue. I'm working on this summarization. So there's a more generic version of summarization, because I talked to the committers and they said, yeah, this can be useful. So I implemented it, and I will contribute it, I think, this week. And the next thing I'd like to work on, which is also can also be a contribution, is graph sampling, which is very important for many use cases where you want to get a good sample of your input graph to make some assumptions on how it looks. And a very interesting, so as you may know, or may understood the problem, so we also use the batch API, the dataset API. And streams are of course very interesting, but graph problems are very hard from nature, and if you want to apply them on streams, it gets even harder. So, but this is a hot topic in research, and we also want to look into that. So I want to maybe continue my work, which I started in my bachelor thesis on graph partitioning, and I also talked to Vazia about that, and we have some ideas, and maybe we can collaborate on that. A very important thing, especially in the business use cases, is graph versioning. So when you want to compare multiple versions of graphs, how they evolved over time, for example. This is more, I think, in my opinion, it's more a storage question, but I don't know yet exactly. Of course, benchmarking is necessary. We have to write papers, and of course, we want to know how the system performs. So this is also future work, and our Krala interpreter is work in progress in combination with a web UI. So let's start with some sneak preview on benchmarking. What we did here is we applied summarization on an input graph, which is defined here. It's a graph that we generated using our graph generator FootBroker. It's a specialized, or it's a tailored data generator for business processes. So there's some semantics inside the graph. And we, our biggest graph at the moment is about 660 gigabytes of payload, and results in 800 million vertices and 4.4 billion edges, which is quite large and can occur in real systems. So we used our cluster here. It's just a simple first approach. We applied a summarization on vertex and edge labels, so like to extract the schema from the graph. And our first results are promising for us. And yeah, we will see how this goes on. And the second thing we are working on, or one of my students, Niklas, is working on, is the web UI, so where you can define your Crawler script here on the left. So this is compiled into Java, and then compiled into bytecode, and then replaced in a jar file, and executed on a server, and the result is given back via REST service, and then visualized, in that case, using Cytoscape.js. So this, for example, is something we want an analyst to work with. So you have your script on the left, and then it gets executed, and you have a nice graph visualization as a result. So, but this is just starting. There are very interesting questions, and yeah, maybe let's see what happens. So of course, contributions are welcome. I know it's a research project. It's not something you can actually in that moment use for production. So we try things out. We have to learn Flink. We have to learn the environment, stuff like that. But if you want to just implement an operator or you're interested in that, just get in contact with me. I already talked to some of the committers about performance, and I got some new ideas which we will implement in the next time. And also, storage layout is interesting. That's more an HBase or HDFS related topic. But if you are also interested in that, maybe we can work together. And what is even more interesting for us researchers, because all we do is we assume things. And of course, we say, OK, this clustering, that could work. It sounds interesting, but we don't know yet because we don't have real data. So if you are a company and you want to give it a try and let us use your data, we can also do it internally, whatever. And yeah, please contact me. And it would be very interesting for us. And yeah, and of course, we can also offer a bachelor, master, and PhD thesis on that topic. And if you're interested in such things, you can also contact me. So yeah, so this is basically it. Yeah, very much for building the framework. We really appreciate working with it. And yeah, if you are more deeply interested into Gradoop, you can just visit the website. There's a technical report which explains the data model and the operators in more detail, and also a bit about the storage. But the execution is the MapReduce and Giraffe, so it's a bit outdated. And there's a VLDB paper on the business intelligence workflow, which I described, also a bit more in detail, of course. So if you're interested in that, just have a look at the links. And thank you very much.